So today we've got the cloud engine.
Woo-hoo!
So I'm going to share with you all of my knowledge about clouds, how to fly with them, how to stay safe around them, and how to get the best out of the day when you've got clouds. So first, some basics. When you've got a sky like this, it won't pop up on the windy wind forecast. Your basic paragliding weather forecasting isn't going to show the tops of the clouds. So you need to pull up something called a SKU-T or a tepigram. Let's do that now. So to understand what's happening here, we really need to get something that's going to show us the temperature lapse rate. What is the temperature doing between the ground and cloud base and above? If you can see that, you can tell how fast the thermal is going to rise. Given the predicted ground temperature, which they get pretty good, pretty accurate on that. So let's say they're expecting 20 degrees on the ground. If I know that the air is cooling at 1 degree every 100 meters from the ground up to cloud base, I know I've got a cracking thermal bay, because that's the speed that a lifted parcel of air will cool at. If you have a thermal, remember the air doesn't like to mix, so that warm thermal bubble stays contained. It doesn't bleed into the air around it, it doesn't mix. It stays like a balloon. You can imagine it like a balloon. And it doesn't really pop. It's the strangest thing. But it'll keep going up until it gets to air that's the same temperature. And then it will mix, because then there's no difference, there's no separation. So that little bubble, that little balloon of ours, if you take the balloon and you physically lifted it, the air in the balloon is going to expand because there's less pressure on it. So as you take that balloon up, it gets colder and colder and colder, the air inside the balloon, because there's less pressure on it. But remember, temperature in a gas is due to how close everything is packed. When the molecules are bouncing against each other, you get a sensation of heat. There's that energy. That's a hot parcel of air. If you make more space in it, it's cooler. There's less of this collision between the little particles and the temperature drops. So if you expand our air by taking it up, it's going to cool. Now you could go out with your paraglider and take your thermometer and thermal up and read the temperature change with altitude. What's that going to give you? It's just going to give you 1 degree centigrade per 100 meters, because that's the dry adiabatic lapse rate. That's the lapse rate that the thermal will cool at. Once you pop out of the thermal and you're in the other air, the environmental air, the sort of air that's out there, not in the thermals, you'll then read another temperature. As you're gliding down through the air, you'll be reading the environmental lapse rate. And that is something that they give us with weather balloons every morning. Depending on what country you're in, they'll send balloons up with a little temperature tracker, and they'll feed that information back to the Met Office. So that's available on the tepigram, on the SKU-T. You can see exactly what this air is on the outside of thermals. That's your starting point. Because once you know that slope, you can predict completely accurately how high the thermals are going to go. Because if you've got a ground temperature, you know it's a steady cooling rate as you go up. If you just map that on the graph, you'll get to a certain height where the thermal is the same temperature as the air outside it. Thermal no more. The thermal will pick up moisture from the air where it starts. So on the ground, there's moisture in these plants, in the ground from the last rains, and that will evaporate and it'll end up in the air around here. There's a certain amount of humidity here. If you take that humidity, that humid air, and you lift it in that little balloon, and you therefore cool it, you'll get to a dew point, the point at which that air will condense. And then you've got cloud. Now that they can measure accurately on the ground, you can tell the humidity of the air mass, you can tell exactly what the dew point is of this air. Therefore, when it's lifted, you know exactly at the height it's going to condense. So that we can predict very accurately. Once we've hit cloud base, the air is now condensing, that moisture is coming back out of the air. Now, if you lick your finger and you blow on it, you'll feel it gets cold. Colder than if you just blew on your finger. The extra cooling that's happening here is the water turning into water vapor. Evaporation takes energy out to make that transformation. When you reverse that, you get the energy back. So when you take water vapor and you turn it back into water, you're going to get the heat that you took out of my finger. It's going to be up there. So that heat release means there's almost a second thermal. That's the cloud engine. At cloud base, you can imagine that as a heating surface. It's now going to start releasing energy into the air, which means temperature, from that point up. So as the air moves up in the cloud, it's not going to cool as fast as it did before it's getting to the cloud. The dry adiabatic lapse rate cools quite quickly. When it gets to the cloud, it starts cooling at a slower rate, which means if your temperature, environmental temperature, is kind of a steady line, when you get to the cloud could actually start pulling away from that line. In other words, the air in the cloud is getting warmer relative to the air outside, the higher you go. And when you've got that, you've got a thunderstorm potential, because that can just keep going up and up and up and up and up and up. It'll just run away with itself. And that's the cloud engine that you've got to be careful of. As you near cloud base, you can expect that whole area to be providing gentle lift. So it's a fantastic line to run along to get underneath one of those clouds and just link cloud to cloud to cloud. But when you're doing that, you have to be super careful that you're not going to go up into the cloud, lose your visibility, and not know where you're going, get cold, wet, and fly into other aircraft. So you want to stay out of the cloud, but you want to use the cloud to get you your distance. So what I would do is I would position myself on the edge of one of these cloud lines, come in just enough that you're getting the lift, and then if you're finding you're getting too much lift, you know you can peel out before you white out. So you can peel out into this gap and come back in again, and you can manage it that way, just riding along the side of one of these long lines of clouds. That cloud keeps going up and up and up. What's going to stop it? An inversion. The only way that cloud's going to stop continuing on that skew T, where you've got a separation between the environmental lapse rate and the saturated adiabatic lapse rate in the cloud, is if that temperature as you go up in the environment warms. So there needs to be an inversion layer where the temperature gets warmer as you go up. So the cloud's going up and up and up, and it meets the warm air, and you get that anvil shape, this continual pushing up of cloud, but it can't go any higher, and it gets pushed over by the stronger wind aloft and the inversion that's capping it. So that height of the inversion is your safety band, and you want to fly in conditions where your cloud base has got maybe, I don't know, 2,000 meters, 3,000 meters up to the top of climb, the top of clouds. If you've got a 2,000 to 3,000 meter cloud, it's manageable. Could have strong lift in it, it's not going to kill you, because if the base is at 2,000 and you're popping out at 5,000, you're cold, but you're not dead. You don't want a cloud that's going to go up to 18,000 feet and spit you out as a cold hypoxic block.
That's the short version. In the extended edition, I go through more detail and I'll take you up to the clouds and show you exactly what it looks like and where the escape routes are, how to keep yourself safe. On the Fly with Greg website, there's a whole series on whether to fly, where I'll take you through step by step my process of analyzing and identifying good days to fly and all of the ins and outs of weather. That series is ongoing. So why not fill up your cup at the fountain of paragliding knowledge? You'll be supporting the channel and you'll take your flying to the next level.
Good lift, nothing scary. Just be sure to come out to the front of the cloud so you've got an escape route. Make sure you've got a big area of sun on the ground that you can see. And take a line on your GPS so you know your heading that you need in case you get too close to the cloud. New flying. So thanks for watching. Thanks for your support. Appreciate it. And stick around, there's lots more to learn. Cheers.